let's quickly get on to the topic. I'm not sure how good we were in elevator pitches. I think we need to do better next time. So starting from Gaurav, from your experience of being a marketplace, and just to give you a quick context, we only have one practitioner in true sense on the panel. We have a consultant, we have a technology company, we have a recruitment company, and we have a marketplace which can also give you a view on demand supply. So in a quick context, the recent report by Deloitte talks about the readiness by HR leaders. It marks about 8-9% of HR leaders as on recently, a few months back report, says that HR leaders are prepared for analytics capabilities in their organization. So while the term HR analytics and big data in HR has been around for more than 2 years, still significant majority of people feel that they are not prepared. So the idea is to also understand from you what areas you feel there is apprehension and ambiguity. We'd like to get into that in Q&A. But Gaurav, from your experience of being a marketplace, what are some of the broad trends in analytics service providers you see? Just to set the context in the beginning.
Sure. Thanks, Ankur. I think very quickly, just to give you a little context of the way I look at analytics and how this world is moving from an HR standpoint. A quick analogy for this, the way I look at it is, using navigation, for instance, right? Now, navigation, all of us use navigation. And most of us use navigation today also on the routes which we know by heart, just to avoid traffic, not get stuck in congestion, and for a host of other things, right? Navigation as a need per se has been there from the time we've been driving, right? Earlier, I remember days when I used to roll down the windows of the car and ask somebody on the road, which turn should I take? Sometimes I would miss the turn and had to possibly come back. And then possibly there was, if we were going far, I also remember using maps, physical maps, to maybe go to a long distance place. And now to the days of Google, where I just say, Google, take me here. And Google does the rest of it. And I need to not even know what roads did I take and just keep following instructions. And I think that's the whole piece which really sets the context of what organizations are also going through when it comes to analytics, right? So data has always been there. Help has always been there. We've used it in different forms of depth and shape, right? The way we look at analytics today, if you run a Google search, you'll get about 100 million results for the word HR analytics, workforce analytics, talent analytics. If you look at Amazon Prime, you'll find at least 1,500 books which have been written on analytics, right? So that's the kind of fad or reality that the concept of HR analytics is really going through. I think Ankur very rightly mentioned a number by Deloitte here, with 8% leaders only feeling confident about analytics. And I'll just give you a little context to this number. We serve a lot of organizations with very different needs, and I'll just maybe share a few needs we've helped organizations solve recently. So we recently had a very large manufacturing automobile company come to us and say that, Gaurav, we've got about 14 different systems running in HR for different aspects of the employee life cycle, right, from recruitment to L&D to HRIS systems and the whole lot of sorts. But there is nothing with us which leverages all the data points and puts in a layer and helps us make intelligent decisions out of it, right? So data has been there, but I think the way industry is maturing, we've had a lot of insular products, a very large amount of specialty products emerge in the market, because of which the larger macro view really remains missing. So that's the one kind of need which we are seeing. We are also seeing a lot happening when it comes to the hiring space and the retention space and the engagement space. There are various specialty tools today available which help you predict. So very recently, IIM Bangalore ran a whole analytics on an IT company where they were hiring about 12,000 people every year for one of their clients. This is an offshore IT recruitment company hiring about 12,000 people in a year. And what they figured out was that about 3,000 of those people were not really even joining, or those offers were getting reneged, right? And a few quick things I saw them really compare in that case was really not just looking at some of the classical indexes, but also looking at aspects like how does having longer notice periods impact joining ratios? How does somebody asking for an extension of a date of joining relate to joining? How do possibly sun signs, you know, relate to joining? And so many types of vectors which they really came through. But I think the largest learning which remains for any analytics is having a hypothesis or a business problem. A lot of times in our industry, we've seen leaders, HR practitioners, try and decode any and all data that they have, which is, I think, a big problem in the first place. So the biggest journey for you to start the journey, really, where we also advise organizations is that what is the hypothesis, what is the problem? Because any analytics will only make sense if it can contribute to the business, if it's outside in and not only led by the center of expertise that you run. Right? So these are a few opening remarks, Ankur, and we'll take it up further.
Sure. Since we're talking about recruiting, Ketan, let's get you in here. When you work with so many companies, what are some of the analytics people are demanding? You know, what are trends in recruiting analytics that you can talk about, and then we get into a little bit more detail later?
So I think there was a question that is analytics making us lose our intuition? So I would say that, in fact, analytics help us sharpen our intuition and validate our intuitions and help us, if there are three intuitions, choose the right intuition in a way. At a very high level, if we talk to any business head today, they will say that I need to grow in 3 years. I need to double my business in 3 years or 5 years. The next question typically is, for that to happen, what is the most important thing? And the answer is typically, my people are the most important thing. Now, who is, and they will say that I need the right people in my organization to help me achieve my numbers. Now, who is this right person in an organization? Typically, just like individuals, every organization have their own unique DNA. Now, what is that DNA? What is the job role? What are the competencies within the job role? How can we match the best person in the world for that particular job role? In a way, that is what we do in the simplest sense, helping companies hire the right people based on the matching of DNA between the individual and the company so that the probability of performance is the maximum. Just putting some mathematical element to it, that in essence is what we do, and everybody needs that. Every organization wants to grow. There will be no organization that would say, nahin, mujhe grow to nahin karna hai, mujhe degrow karna hai. Every organization works for the shareholders, wants to grow, and wants to have the right people, helping them take the right decisions on the recruitment side. And again, we can go one level deeper. We need to understand whether the person has cognitive skills or not, has behavioral skills, has the right personality, has the right domain skills to do that job. What are the thresholds in terms of levels or proficiency of those skills? What are the thresholds and benchmarks that will work for that organization? What exactly is working today in that organization? So these are some of the questions that get thrown up as we go one level deeper. I would just like to add, on the recruitment side, we help hire the right people. On the L&D side, we help on the kind of solve for who should be trained, what should they be trained on, and how should they be trained. Who, again, there are, if somebody has 10,000, so IBM is a very large company, they would have 150,000 people in India. How do I decide who should be trained in what skill? Is there some sort of a proximity index of skills that if somebody is good in X skill, there's an X prime skill which is very close to that skill? What is the learning ability or learning agility of that individual to undertake that new skill? Some people might be very comfortable, very eager to go out of the comfort zones, others might not be. So then doing some sort of redundancy analysis, let's say out of a universe of 800 skills in an organization, what are the 200 skills that will become or are likely to become redundant in the next 5 to 10 years? So the imperative of the organization to train people in those job roles or skills is higher than otherwise. So these are some of the questions and challenges before us. Some of these questions were not there even 2 years back, but they are there today. Our own company's maturity to even digest and handle some of these questions and provide solutions which are scalable, which are tech-enabled, which will solve for speed, scale, and reach is improving day by day. And obviously, there are age-old questions of, we are an assessments company, so how do we ensure the authenticity of the test? How do we ensure that I can measure, let's say, creativity in a better way? How do I ensure validity of, let's say, a new type of question that I've come about, that it is actually measuring the right thing? So in a way, we kind of deal with, we kind of produce data for every assessment that we do. And I would say it, we are like on the first or second floor of a very tall building in terms of the maturity of the analytics as an industry.
Interesting. So let's go to you, Seema, now, being a large organization, an HR practitioner, and this context. What are some of the things that you see in the future, and what are the, you know, high-level experiments in analytics and investments that you're doing? Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, can you hear me? Yes. So I think, you know, being a large and a complex organization, and also when you look at a business, you know, slowly we are transforming our business. There have been strategic shifts, deliberate shifts in a business from what we were earlier to what we are, you know, today. It's becoming very, very important for us in HR to be able to be there to support our, you know, business with having the right, and we are a manpower intensive company. Our company is, you know, what we do in IT is all because how we have people, what kind of people we have, the mix to achieve success. So, you know, some of the areas where we focused on in analytics, somewhere like, you know, somewhere we, and we are in the various stages of journey in all of them. So we've been covering in analytics in terms of using machine learning to guide us to take informed decisions to help us, you know, gain a competitive advantage for a business and to address a people requirement. We have used this to a great extent in recruitment, in performance management, in learning. The latest work which we've just started and we've piloted in, you know, three countries, which is India, UAE, and South Africa, was on compensation. You know, we realize that there's a lot of investment, incremental investment that we see in compensation, and there's not much work going on in how do you help managers take informed decisions, you know, on which people to reward. And those are those decisions not purely performance-based, but aligned to the business requirements in terms of the skills that we work for, the potential the individual has to grow that business, and the market competitiveness, you know, besides the performance. So there's a lot of work which has just started, and we piloted, and we've seen almost about, we started, there was a 60% success, now, you know, it's moved to 80%, and now we are trying to, you know, see if we can spread it across the other parts of the globe. There's a lot of work gone on in learning, you know, as we have cross-generation of people working with different learning needs, as the technology is changing at a very rapid pace. So we've tried to develop, you know, a tool which in and a platform which where an individual can choose learning at his or her pace and decide on the approach in which they want to take for the learning. So if I am somebody who has a short span of time, want to do a 20 minutes module gamification, the tool analyzes your past and offers you those kind of learning. You know, if I have a career aspiration to be there somewhere 3 years later, it tells me this is where you are. These are the three or four training interventions. If you do, it might help you get there. Or, you know, it helps as in if I'm a technical professional, I'm working in one technical skill, it tells me whether my skill is in the growth stage or I have to maintain it or it's in a declining phase and what are the trainings I need to do to move from a, you know, from a declining phase to a growth phase and what is the time span it will take me to get there. So those are some of the examples where we are leveraging, you know, analytics and machine learning combined with it to, you know, kind of get to support business.
Interesting. Let me go to Sunil now before I come to you, Neha. Sunil, running a very large recruiting business, about 700-800 recruiters, very large team. As a business leader, how are you leveraging analytics, both internally and, you know, of course, the disruption that's happening in the market? There are bigger players as platform which are eating into your, you know, market pie. How are you using analytics to create a niche for your business and carve out a growth plan?
See, I started doing recruiting when the hard copies used to be in the fashion. You know, we used to receive applications through couriers. We used to number them. You know, I mean, it used to be a very long process when you go and assess. And we remember as a recruiting company, if you used to have a name of the 10 people and we used to go and take their annual reports and dig out the name of the people And those name and numbers used to be like a big asset, you know, that, okay, I have this kind of names and numbers with us. Market changed, demand changed. I think total number changed in the markets. So what we used to do it, what we did it in one decade, we did it in 2 years or 1 year kind of a things in terms of number. That's how the numbers volume also changed. Since I run a market for India, we have a separate entity runs in US and Europe in different markets. The market challenges are different in each of these locations, but the basics remains very, very similar. Other markets, what we found that number of people are less. You don't get the number of people. That's the one of the reason for a delay for recruiting. In India, you have too many people. So that's the reason for a delay for a recruiting, right? So when you have to go and filter out the things and the information goes overlapped so much, so your resource, you know, end up doing repetitive job time and again. So maybe to search for a one person, you're doing that activity time and again, and you do not have any historical information of the person which has been done. It's similar like somebody invented a drug and then he lost it, and again somebody's going and inventing a drug again, right? So it was a like exercise like this. But how the technology has helped us capturing the history of an individual, his liking, his preferences, his capabilities, his skills areas, and also the gray areas like this person never goes for interview, right? Or this person has dropped the offer 3 times. So the capturing these histories comes through these analytical platforms. So as and when a principal or a recruiter goes and talks to these people, he says, hey, my colleague was so-and-so touch. What has happened last time? Why didn't you take up this job? And we expect that a lot of time the people has to be genuine about this time, because they know otherwise the third time these guys are not gonna call up. So what we have seen is the information system. So maybe the information was managed before as well. It was manual, then it came to very basics. You manage on Excel, then manage in Access. Then you come to databases, then you come to big data, and then you, how do you leverage that big data information to analytics? It means how do you draw an information that today this company, which is an organization from where you are getting these skills, can be your customer as well, right? So that's where we looked at the lot of information. Today, if I go and talk to an organization, every time they have a challenge is to recruit the people, right set of the people. I think most of our panelists also said that. Because 50% of the time, the business confuses them that what do they want. They are not sure what do they want. They write a job description on something else. While interviewing, they give assessment something else. But the data point has always helped every HR professionals or a TA professionals to go and represent that this is the market availability, this is the geographical availability, these are the compensations, these are the culture fitment, this company professionals we can afford and this company professionals we can't afford because we have a lower benchmarking of the compensation, or these professionals from these companies do not fit culturally because in the past we hired 5 and 4 of them have left the job. So this is what the analytics is. So as an organization today, when we look at and we go to analyze the job of a person, analytics helps doing a justice with the individual's career. It means we are not putting them at the wrong place. Second, also doing a justice to the organization by recruiting them the right people. Now, these are the information system when we look at and go back that how it leverages, because today resource time is the money for us. There's another interesting fact I like to say that in my company, typically, all the recruiters and principals get paid for every minute. So we developed a system where they have a certain hours to contribute. Every extra minute contributed to other people, they get compensated with the salary in terms of money. So we started giving them a value of time that how do you leverage it, how do you optimize it? And that's where the value proposition comes to an individual's life, because today you see the telecom companies has made the calling free. You pay 500 rupees. 10 GB data, 20 GB data, no calling charges. Because in the 2 years from now, you would not like to receive too many phone calls. You like to see the information. Is it worth for you to get on the call or not get into the call? You like to see your communications mails. You like to see the history. When did this last person call me? I mean, what was the update? Did he respond to you? Today, as a recruiter, call you, and then I stop after that. You say, hey, you called me for a job. You took every details from me, and then what happened? Right? So I'm liable to respond to you based on the information history and everything that, hey, you're supposed to get any feedback. So as an organization, when we look at today, when you are in a people business, we all are in a people business. We do recruiting, we do training and development, we do compensation benefits. It should not happen that somebody has a need that he really needs a he wants to change the job because of money, but you are selling him the job role and the organization. You say, hey, I'm not interested. I need to know because I'm underpaid from the industry parameters. Vice versa situation. You go and talk to a guy, says, I'm ready to take a cut 20% because I've landed to a wrong organization. Culturally, I'm not enjoying this. I've earned enough. I need a good role. So this kind of analytics and history where you manage on a platforms and it pops you up as an individual when the user uses those information and the data and gives the right solution. So as an organization today, we look at that connectivity with the individuals on professional front, on emotional fronts, on the liking. You don't ask the same questions time and again. You don't go and give those details to him which he doesn't need or which he already knows. So I believe that these are the information systems and the technology platforms in forms of you do a, earlier that training and need analysis used to have an individual to individuals. Now today machines does the training need analysis. So these are the area which really helps in terms of recruiting when we actually go and talk to the professionals and give them a right job solutions.
Sure, sure. Interestingly, being a recruiting company, when you hire people within the team, how much do you rely on gut and how much do you rely on analytics for your own team?
See, analytics, if I give you other way around. So today, somebody who has written the online test, the perception changes when you're interviewing him, when you have a score in front of you. But when you actually you don't have a score in front of you, then you totally rely on a gut. So these are the two parameters. When you have a first one, you're always sure about your decisions. Otherwise, you always think and you go on an individual specific question answer observations that he did answer this, so he's very good. There's a possibility the rest of the thing doesn't know. But when you have analytics information, either writing a psychometric test or writing a skill set test or anything, those reports always helps you to take a right decision and you assess on the areas where you have found the person weaker on the analytics. It means if somebody has not scored good on ethical area, let's say today we go and do a test of a person, you try and stress on that area. So this becomes a tool while you're assessing physically, emotionally to try to do a person which machines can't do it, but you have some parameters, as I mentioned in my introduction, that doctors looks at your blood report, looks at your radiology, pathology report, and radiology reports, and based on that, he decides that what is going to be good, right, for you. So that's sure. How it works as information.
Sure. Neha, let's talk about BCG's work. We were talking earlier, and you were mentioning your work with the biggest bank in the country. Tell us a little bit about more on the mindset change as well, because analytics starts with a change in mindset of how we are used to doing things this way. So tell us a little bit on that.
Absolutely. So what you said in the end is probably the most interesting of how the mindset is changing. One of the banks that BCG has worked with a lot on the HR aspect is the State Bank of India. And 3 years back when actually we started this work, for a 2 lakh employee base, a lot of them in the business front, only 30% roughly used to get measured on numbers. And that, over time, the bank has actually changed to 90% employees. So across all cadres, across all grades, 90% of the employees actually get measured on system-driven data. And the bank has started going 2 steps ahead. So not just saying, where are you versus target, but it can say that at a level of in retail loans of this type of category, how are you doing versus other employees, for example? So when we go and shop online, we all get recommendations. People like you bought so and so. Similarly, can we do analytics to say employees like you have done so and so to get to their objectives? That's the kind of mindset shift that's happening in banks. Similarly, the other thing that's happening is a lot of times the mindset used to be of performance is measured only to give the compensation. But can I measure performance on an ongoing basis to actually help the employee perform better? So rather than just saying you missed your target by 20% or you overachieved by 20%, can I actually say what are the 2 actionable steps that you need to change to actually achieve your target? And I do that on a real-time basis so that I can ensure that at the end of the quarter or the end of the month, the employee actually does achieve the target. So that's the mindset shift of HR being reactive to HR being more proactive to help the employees deliver business results. So I think that's one big business shift that's happening from an HR perspective. Similarly, on the recruiting front, on training. So we used to have something called segment of one, which is in the business world, can I individualize customer offers? Similarly, that segment of one is for employees now. Can I have individual development plans? Can I have specific retention mechanisms before even the employee starts thinking about it? So that's the kind of mindset shifts that we are seeing.